My name is Jan, and last week we added a new Facebook friend. I don't know if you guys heard. Actually, we're really excited to be here and to talk to everybody about what we're doing and what we're going to be doing. Mark is actually here this week as well, and he's going to be speaking about internet.org, which we think is actually a really amazing thing that he's working on, so you can go and hear him speak at 6 o'clock. But I want to start a little bit talking about our history. Today is actually a very special day for us, everybody at WhatsApp. Today is February 24th. It's the anniversary of the company creation. We were founded on February 24th of 2009, and I actually remember driving up to San Francisco and registering WhatsApp at the sunny state of California. And 5 years ago, we had no users, we had no revenue, we didn't even have a product. We had a prototype, it didn't work really well, it actually sucked. But we had a vision, we wanted to build something really cool, we were passionate about building a product. And so we started, and we set out to build a cool product, but we also had some specific values that we wanted to put into the product. We wanted to make it simple to use and very intuitive. We wanted it to be fast. We wanted it to always work. And we wanted it to connect people. It was important for us to build a product that was not cluttered by gimmicks or promotions. And it was part of our mission to just build something that would connect people. That's it. We didn't want to do much else. Because of those values and because of what we set out to do, today we have 465 million monthly active users. 465 million monthly active users. And I think we're at 330 million daily users. Almost 1/3 of a billion people use our product today to communicate and stay in touch. And we couldn't be more humbled by our growth. It's been very exciting for us. And we promise not to change that. We promise to build and continue to build what's important to us, what's in our heart and our mind. It's that philosophy of building something that makes people connected and stay in touch, and a product that is simple to use, intuitive, uncluttered, with a very simple user experience. We started out trying to build a product, but there was a turning point when we realized we're actually onto something else here. We were working in this kind of rundown warehouse in 2010, and we were working on releasing BlackBerry beta version. We had one of our early engineers, Chris, who is a friend of mine, work on it, and back then we only had iPhone, and I think that was it. And I got an email from this girl. She lived in Australia, and she was an exchange student, and she basically sent me an email saying, I'm all by myself in Australia. I don't have any family here, and it costs money for me to send them a message or to call them. Can you please give me a beta version of WhatsApp for BlackBerry so I can stay in touch? And she wrote this very touching email where she said, like, I cry myself to sleep because I'm all by myself. And I couldn't say no, so obviously I sent her a link and I said, please don't give this link to anybody. But I think that's the moment when we realized that we have a mission here. We have a mission of making sure that people can communicate easily and affordably, no matter where you are in the world. And that's what we set out to do. And we're really excited about what we've achieved. It's really been quite amazing for us. But we're here to make, actually, a very interesting announcement. And before I do that, I want to tell you guys a story. As some of you know, I grew up in Russia, in USSR, countries that no longer exist, actually. And we grew up under a communist regime. I have some friends here who actually grew up in Russia as well. And luckily enough, my family had a telephone line, and we could make calls and receive calls on a landline. But a lot of my friends didn't, and a lot of my neighbors didn't. And I remember as a kid, my friends and our neighbors would come over and ask my parents if they could use a phone. In a way, it became a shared resource. Like our landline phones that we had, where we could like rotary dial, became a shared resource for the whole apartment complex. And I remember that vividly growing up, where people would like knock on our door and say, "Hey, can I use your phone? I have to call my relatives in a different city." We're driven by a mission to make sure that people can stay in touch. And we want to make sure that the situations that I just described does not happen anywhere else. You've heard people earlier talk about connecting people in emerging worlds and providing data plans. And we're really excited about that too. We also believe that data will drive the future. Because of my experience as a child, today we're announcing that we're going to introduce voice on WhatsApp in the second quarter of this year. We want to make sure that people always have ability to stay in touch and call their friends and family and their loved ones and do it easily and affordably. We're actually really excited about what we've built. We think we have the best voice product out there. We use the least amount of bandwidth and we optimize the hell out of it. The same value that made our messaging the leading messaging platform in the world will be applied to voice. We will focus on simplicity, and we will make sure that the same gold standard for messaging, where we make sure that the quality is there, will be applied to voice. We will launch on Android and iPhone first, and after that we will follow with Windows Phone and BlackBerry, some BlackBerry phones and some Nokia phones. So we couldn't be more excited about it. I actually can't wait to get back on a plane and go back to Mountain and work with our team to get it done. We're going to try to release it in a few months, but Q2 of 2014 is what we're targeting. You heard people here talk about data. Thank you. Somebody likes voice. You heard people here. You heard Tele2 talk about data and how they're excited about data. I actually brought something very special with me today on stage. I wanted to make sure, I brought it all the way from San Francisco, and I wanted to make sure this morning as I was getting to the conference, I'm like, did I bring this? Okay, I did. So, this is my old Nokia 6230 phone. Who remembers these? This phone is about 10 years old, but it's very dear to me. I went to Ukraine in 2004 to visit my aunt, and I brought this phone with me. And I also had my MacBook. I took some time off work. And I remember trying to connect to the internet using this phone. I basically tethered it via Bluetooth to my laptop. And I didn't have 4G back then. I didn't have 3G. I didn't even have Edge. I think I had like a really weak GPRS signal. It was really freaking slow. But 10 years ago, I realized that the world is moving to data very quickly. And it might take 10 years or 15 years or 20 years. But the future, in our view, is going to be all about data. It's not going to be about minutes or messages. It's going to be about bits and bytes. You've already seen people talk about data earlier today and how they're making sure that applications like Facebook and WhatsApp can always be accessible. And that's what we believe. We believe that data is fundamentally going to be the next generation of what is driving the mobile industry forward. We're also really excited about partnerships with carriers. In the next couple of months, we're going to do this really awesome deal with ePlus in Germany. We will take the WhatsApp brand and we'll partner with ePlus, and we'll introduce a WhatsApp mobile brand in Germany. This is an example of where we're working with carriers in established markets to bring value to the end user. I just want to finish real quick was something that I wanted to say for a while. You know, a lot of times we talk about numbers and we talk about user growth. We as a company have done zero marketing. We've never done any user acquisition. We've never done any marketing or advertising. And every single one of our users has joined WhatsApp because their friends begged them to. And we want to thank every one of our users who convince their friends to get WhatsApp. So thank you, each and every one of you, for getting your friends to use our product. We couldn't do it without you. And I think this is it. Thank you.
Jan, you speak so eloquently about how what a personal vision this company was for you in terms of your upbringing. Are you amazed that 430 million people agree with you, or did you think, yeah, I'm, from the moment that you came up with this concept, 4 years to the date, did you know that this wasn't just going to be your own view that you needed to connect cheaply? You could feel that it was a part missing in the market.
No, it's important. Well, yeah, we are amazed. 465 million monthly active users is a lot. And we're only getting started. Our goal is to grow. Our goal is to actually get every single smartphone user to use WhatsApp, including even people in Korea. So I think we're absolutely amazed. But you know, when I was a kid, when I was a teenager, my mom took me to the United States and we immigrated to the United States. And think back to 1992. There was no internet. There was no email. And the only way to stay in touch was you had to make these long-distance calls. And in the United States, you had like these weird carriers. You had MCI and Sprint, AT&T, and you had to like sign up for different plans. And they would like try to get you to sign up for minutes. It was such a complicated mess. Now you just pick up the phone and you call. You don't even think about it. Like, what is long distance, right? So yeah, I mean, part of it is my upbringing and not being able to stay in touch with friends and family when I was a teenager and going to a different country. And that's why the letters that I mentioned today was very personal to me and so touching. But I think it's also very humbling to us how many people agree with that vision and want to stay in touch and communicate.
There's obviously going to be many people out there knowing also your views on wanting to keep things private as well. The people moving to WhatsApp, a lot has been in reaction to these blasts that people put up on the social media groups such as Facebook of sharing what should be relatively sentimental photos with the entire world in terms of their connections. Are people going to be worrying that now you're going to be part of Facebook, going to be owned by Facebook, that somehow that might be diluted, your vision of keeping things private, of but remaining cheap and affordable? What can you say to those sort of concerns?
Yeah, absolutely. We had a number of people ask us this question. And look, the partnerships that me and Mark will have couldn't have been done without us agreeing on the vision for the product. And he understands better than anybody that in order for WhatsApp to be successful, it really needs to stay independent and have the autonomy that we will have, similar to how Instagram is, in a way, an independent entity and operates independently. And I think the fundamental message is that there are no planned changes. We will continue to execute on our goal and our missions the way we set out to execute, even after the acquisition closes. And we can only achieve and get our product to 1 billion users, to 2 billion users, if we continue down the path that we started on.
So still no marketing?
Still no marketing.
So what does Facebook get from your point of view?
Well, I think as Mark mentioned in an investor call, anytime you have ability to get 1 billion people on a platform, it's a very valuable tool for people to build an open and communicated network, right? So if you look at Facebook mission, they really talk about being building something to make world more open and more connected. And I think connected is what has really been important to us. And so our vision and our mission is kind of aligned in that concept. We both want to make the world more connected and have people communicate easily, as I was mentioning earlier. You know, for me, growing up in a country where you couldn't communicate easily, that wasn't that exciting, right? It's not that good.
You want to be more connected. Also, you say more open, but a lot of the process of bringing WhatsApp to existence was the concern that when you're in the Ukraine, people could listen in on your phone calls. You wanted to keep things private. We're in a furor at the moment of the fallout of the NSA. Privacy seems to be front and center. What do you feel about that debate? Is enough being done to keep user data private? How will you square that circle as well when Facebook quite clearly wants everyone to be far more open and more?
Right. Well, our philosophy on that has been very simple, actually. We, as a company and as a product, actually want to know as little as possible about our users. And you know, we don't know your name or where you live or your email address. And there are no plans to change that. I mean, fundamentally, as I said, 3 minutes ago. For WhatsApp to continue to be successful, we need to continue to execute on the path that we've set out to execute. So we have no plans to change anything that we do with the product today. We want to continue to have that minimalistic approach to the product because that's fundamental what makes it useful. We, as WhatsApp, want to get out of the way and just let people communicate. We want to have them exchange messages and say, I love you and have a good night or have a good morning, right? And so for us, what we've been doing before will continue to be the kind of like modus operandi going forward.
In terms of the size of your company, it's notorious, it's very small. What is that, 50 individuals?
55.
How will that grow?
Hopefully not a lot. We don't want to become a thousands of people kind of company or division or unit. We want to operate as a startup. And it's important for us to be nimble and be agile. I mean, our industries are changing so quickly. I mean, 5 years ago, almost nobody had a smartphone, and now everybody has a smartphone. And so we don't even know what's going to happen 5 years from now. It's important for us to stay small. But at the same time, we're hiring. So if anybody out there is looking for a job and is a good engineer, send me your resume. We're always hiring good engineers. But I think fundamentally for us, the company will continue to be very engineering and customer support focused, which is what it has been historically. We're extremely engineering and customer support focused.
And you told us that story about how you had just GPRS when you're desperately trying to hook your Nokia up to your computer. Is infrastructure a problem? Is the fact that 4G isn't being rolled out, is 4G being rolled out quickly enough? Is the speed to get onto the internet quick enough?
I'm not a very patient person. I want 4G everywhere. In fact, I want every single person in the world to have access to 4G. I mean, that would be so freaking awesome if people, every person in the world, and I think that's where internet.org comes in, and you can hear Mark talk about it, if every person in the world can have access to bandwidth, can have access to Wikipedia and Facebook and WhatsApp and those fundamental basic resources that are almost as important to you as water and electricity. And so in my mind, no, it's not fast enough, but we're also in applications that is not very data hungry. In fact, we try to be very careful about our network usage and data usage, and we work extremely well even on edge. We hear stories of people who have phones that can only operate on edge, and they use WhatsApp just fine.
Well, we'll be talking much more about your announcement, I hope, when we have a panel discussion about the use more of voice with WhatsApp as well. But it's been wonderful speaking to you, Jan Koum. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you so much.
CEO and co-founder of WhatsApp.